Dog sense. How the new science of dog behavior can make you a better friend to your pet. By John Bradshaw. Narrated by Michael Page. Copyright 2011 by John Bradshaw. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Basic Books, a member of the Perseus Books Group, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Preface. The first dog I became attached to was one I never met. He was my grandfather's Cairn Terrier, Ginger, a typical long-legged Cairn of the early 20th century, only a few generations removed from his working forebears. Ginger had died long before I was born, and I grew up in a pet-free household. Stories about Ginger were, for a while, the nearest I came to having a dog of my own. My grandfather, an architect, liked to walk. He walked to and from his office in the industrial city of Bradford and to and from the churches and mill buildings he specialized in. But especially he walked for recreation, whether in the Yorkshire moors or in the Lake District or in Snowdonia. Whenever he could, he took Ginger with him. The family maintained that Ginger, who was taller than he should have been for his breed, had acquired his longer than average legs through all this exercise. Actually, in the photographs I have of him, he looks quite typical of his breed, and not unlike the Cairn chosen to play Toto in the 1939 movie The Wizard of Oz. It was not until much later on, when I became professionally interested in pedigree dogs, that I was struck by how much the breed had changed over the intervening decades, including becoming significantly shorter in the leg. I doubt many modern Cairns would enjoy the amounts of exercise that my grandfather evidently relished, although Cairns today are less prone to inherited diseases than many other breeds are. Ginger was a genuine Yorkshire character, and the family had a fund of stories about him, but what amazed me the most was the freedom he had been given, even though he lived within sight of the city centre. Every lunchtime, when my grandfather was at work, Ginger was allowed to take himself for a walk around the neighbourhood. Apparently, he had a routine. First, he would cross the road into Lister Park, where he would sniff lampposts, interact with other dogs, and, in summer, try to persuade the occupants of the park benches to part with one of their sandwiches. Then he would cross the tram tracks on Manningham Lane and amble to the rear of the fish and chip shop, where a scratch at the back door would usually elicit a handful of scraps of batter and some misshapen chips. Then he usually headed straight for home, which involved crossing a busy junction. Here, according to family legend, there was usually a policeman directing the lunchtime traffic, who would solemnly stop the cars to allow Ginger safe passage across. I've not been to Bradford for many years, but if other cities are anything to go by, Lister Park is probably now ringed with poop bins. Most of the dogs walked there are at the end of a leash, and the Bradford dog wardens are called out to catch any dog that routinely roams the park, let alone the nearby streets. The trams are long gone, of course, and traffic lights have replaced policemen on point duty, but I doubt that one of today's body-armored community support officers would dare to stop a car to allow a small brown terrier to cross the road, even if he or she wanted to. 70-odd years have passed since Ginger was allowed to roam the streets and charm his way into the affections of everyone he met, including the local law enforcement officers. During that same period, almost unnoticed, there have been enormous changes in society's attitudes toward man's best friend. Such attitudes were still quite relaxed when I was growing up in 1970s Britain. My first dog, a Labrador Jack Russell Cross named Alexis, was also a roamer, although he was more interested in the opposite sex than in lunchtime snacks. Despite our best efforts to keep him in sight, he would manage to get away once in a while, and so, unlike Ginger, he did end up in police kennels a few times. In those days, the police in the UK still had responsibility for stray dogs. But no one seemed to mind much. Nowadays, such tolerance of dogs and their ways is hard to find, especially in cities, and dog ownership is showing signs of retreating to its roots in the countryside. After many millennia in which the dog had been man's closest animal companion, cats are taking over as the most popular pet in many countries, including the United States. Why is this happening? First of all, dogs are expected to be much better controlled than they used to be. There has never been a shortage of experts telling owners how to take charge of their dogs. When I took on my second dog, a Labrador Airedale Terrier cross named Ivan, I was determined that he would be better behaved than Alexis. I decided I ought to find out something about training, but was then shocked to discover the approach adopted by the trainers of the day, such as Barbara Woodhouse, who seemed to see the dog as something that needed to be dominated at all times. This simply didn't make sense to me. The whole point of having dogs as pets was for them to become friends, not slaves. As I researched, I found that this approach to training had stemmed from the ideas of Colonel Conrad Most, a police officer and a pioneer in dog training who, more than 100 years ago, had decided that a man could control a dog only if the dog was convinced that the man was physically superior. He derived this idea from contemporary biologists' accounts of wild wolf packs, which at that time were considered to be controlled by one individual who ruled the others through fear. Biology, by then my profession, seemed to be at odds with my gut feeling as to how my relationship with my dogs ought to work. To my relief, this dilemma has resolved itself over the past decade. The wolf pack, always the touchstone for the interpretation of dog behavior, is now known to be a harmonious family group, except when human intervention renders it dysfunctional. As a consequence, the most enlightened modern trainers have largely abandoned the use of punishment, relying on reward-based methods that have their roots in comparative psychology. Yet for some reason, old-school trainers continue to dominate the media, largely, I suspect, because their confrontational methods make for a more exciting spectacle. While a more sympathetic understanding of dogs' minds is being applied to training, albeit patchily, their physical health has been progressively undermined. As more and more demands have been placed on the family dog in terms of hygiene, control, and behavior, the breeding of dogs who might be suited for this ever more demanding niche has been left in the hands of enthusiasts whose primary goal is to produce dogs that look good. Ginger, although he came from pedigree stock, was only 10 or so generations away from Scottish and Irish rat catchers of no particular breeding, and, as a result, led a long and healthy life. Now the Cairn Terrier is in danger of becoming the victim of inbreeding for the show ring, plagued by over a dozen hereditary complaints such as the exotically named but apparently excruciatingly painful leg calve perte's disease. Biologists now know far more about what really makes dogs tick than they did even a decade ago, but this new understanding has been slow to percolate through to owners and, indeed, has not yet made enough of a difference to the lives of the dogs themselves. Having studied the behavior of dogs for over 20 years, as well as enjoying their company, I felt it was time that someone stood up for dogdom. Not the caricature of the wolf in a dog suit, ready to dominate his unsuspecting owner at the first sign of weakness, not the trophy animal who collects rosettes and kudos for her breeder, but the real dog, the pet who just wants to be a member of the family and enjoy life. Introduction. The dog has been our faithful companion for tens of thousands of years. Today, dogs live alongside humans all across the globe, often as an integral part of our families. To many people, a world without dogs is unthinkable. And yet dogs today unwittingly find themselves on the verge of a crisis, struggling to keep up with the ever-increasing pace of change in human society. Until just over 100 years ago, most dogs worked for their living. Each of the breeds or types had become well-suited over thousands of years and a corresponding number of generations to the task for which they were bred. First and foremost, dogs were tools. Their agility, quick thinking, keen senses, and unparalleled ability to communicate with humans suited them to an extraordinary diversity of tasks: hunting, herding, guarding, and many others, each an important component of the economy. In short, dogs had to earn their keep. Apart from the few lapdogs who were the playthings of the very rich, the company that dogs provided would have been incidental, rewarding, but not their raison d'être. Then, a few dozen generations ago, everything began to change, and these changes are still gathering pace today. Indeed, an ever-increasing proportion of dogs are never expected to work at all. Their sole function is to be family pets. Although many working types have been successfully adapted, others were and still are poorly suited to this new role, so it is perhaps surprising that none of the breeds that are most popular as family pets have been specifically and exclusively designed as such. Thus far, dogs have done their best to adjust to the many changes and restrictions we've imposed upon them. In particular, our expectation that they will be companionable when we need them to be and unobtrusive when we don't. However, the cracks inherent in this compromise are beginning to widen. As human society continues to change and the planet becomes ever more crowded, there are signs that the popularity of dogs as pets has peaked and that their adaptation to yet another lifestyle may be a struggle, especially in urban environments. After all, dogs as living beings cannot be re-engineered every decade or so as if they were computers or cars. In the past, when dogs' functions were mostly rural, it was accepted that they were intrinsically messy and needed to be managed on their own terms. Today, by contrast, many pet dogs live in circumscribed urban environments and are expected to be simultaneously better behaved than the average human child and as self-reliant as adults. As if these new obligations were not enough, many dogs still manifest the adaptations that suited them for their original functions, traits that we now demand they cast away as if they had never existed. The collie who herds sheep is the shepherd's best friend. The pet collie who tries to herd children and chases bicycles is an owner's nightmare. The new unrealistic standards to which many humans hold their dogs have arisen from one of several fundamental misconceptions about what dogs are and what they have been designed to do. We must come to better understand their needs and their nature if their niche in human society is not to diminish. Our rapidly changing expectations are not the only challenge that dogs face today. The ways in which we now control their reproduction also represent a major challenge to their well-being. For much of human history, dogs were bred to suit the roles that humankind assigned to them. But whether their task was herding, retrieving, guarding, or hauling, dogs' stability and functionality were considered far more important than their type or appearance. In the late 19th century, however, dogs were grouped into self-contained breeds, reproductively isolated from one another, and each assigned a single ideal appearance, or standard, by breed societies. For many dogs, this rigid categorization has not worked out well. Rather, it has worked against their need to adapt into their new primary role as companions. Each breeder strives not to breed the perfect pet, but to produce the perfect-looking dog who will succeed in the show ring. These winning dogs are considered prized stock and make a hugely disproportionate genetic contribution to the next generation, resulting in pure breeds whose idealized appearance belies their deteriorated health. In the 1950s, most breeds still had a healthy range of genetic variation. By 2000, only some 20 to 25 generations later, many had been inbred to the point where hundreds of genetically based deformities, diseases, and disadvantages had emerged, potentially compromising the welfare of every purebred dog. In the UK, the growing rift between dog breeders and those concerned with dogs' welfare finally became public in 2008, resulting in the withdrawal of the humane charities, and subsequently that of BBC Television, the event's broadcaster, from Crufts, the country's national dog show. While such protests are a start, the dogs themselves will not feel any benefit until the problems brought about by excessive inbreeding have been reversed, and dogs are bred with their health and role in society, not their looks, in mind. Ultimately, people will have to change their attitudes if the dog's lot is to improve. So far, however, neither the experts nor the average owner have had their preconceived notions challenged by the wealth of new science that is emerging about dogs. Much of the public debate thus far, whether about the merits of outbreeding versus inbreeding or the effectiveness of training methods, has amounted to little more than the statement and restatement of entrenched opinions. This is where scientific understanding becomes essential, for it can tell us what dogs are really like and what their needs really amount to. Science is an essential tool for understanding dogs, but the contributions of canine science to dog welfare have, unfortunately, been somewhat mixed. Canine science, which originated in the 1950s, sets out to provide a rational perspective on what it's like to be a dog, a perspective ostensibly more objective than the traditional human-centered or anthropomorphic view of their natures. Despite this attempt at detachment, however, canine scientists have occasionally misunderstood, and even given others the license to cause injury to, the very animals whose nature they have endeavored to reveal. Science has unwittingly done the most damage to dogs by applying the comparative zoology approach to studies of dog behavior. Comparative zoology is a well-established and generally valuable way of understanding the behavior and adaptations of one species through comparisons with those of another. Species that are closely related but have different lifestyles can often be better understood through comparative zoology because differences in the way they look and behave mirror those changes in lifestyle. So, too, can those species that have come to have similar lives but are genetically unrelated. This method has been highly successful in helping to disentangle the mechanisms of evolution in general, especially now that similarities and differences in behavior can be compared with differences between each species' DNA so as to pinpoint the genetic basis of behavior. Yet although the applications of comparative zoology are usually benign, it has done considerable harm to dogs, as one expert after another has interpreted their behavior as if they were, under the surface, little altered from that of their ancestor, the wolf. Wolves, which have generally been portrayed as vicious animals, constantly striving for dominance over every other member of their own kind, have been held up as the only credible model for understanding the behavior of dogs. This supposition leads inevitably to the misconception that every dog is constantly trying to control its owner, unless its owner is relentless in keeping it in check. The conflation of dog and wolf behavior is still widely promoted in books and on television programs, but recent research on both dogs and wolves has shown not only that it is simply unfounded, but also that dogs who do come into conflict with their owners are usually motivated by anxiety, not a surfeit of ambition. Since this fundamental misunderstanding has crept into almost every theory of dog behavior, it will be the first to be addressed in this book. Despite the misapplication of comparative zoology, more recent scientific discoveries could, if applied properly, benefit dogs considerably. Although canine science went into eclipse in the 1970s and 80s, the 1990s saw the field's resurgence, which has continued to the present day. After nearly 50 years of almost total neglect, this extraordinary uplift in scientific interest in the domestic dog has been driven partly by the increasing role that dogs play in detecting substances such as explosives, drugs, and other illicit substances, which they still sniff out more effectively than any machine, and the attendant realization that humans need to better understand how dogs perform these tasks. It has also been due to the shift in attention from the chimpanzee to the domestic dog on the part of a few primatologists who have attempted to gain fresh insights into the way that animal and human minds work. A further contribution has come from veterinarians and other clinicians who wish to improve the therapies available for treating dogs with behavioral disorders. Finally, it should not be forgotten that many biologists are dog lovers too. Once the professional stigma of working on so-called artificial animals has been overcome, such scientists are often keen to apply their skills to improving dogs' lives. By further pulling back the curtain on dogs' inner lives, the new school of canine science has the potential to provide everyday dog owners with new ways of thinking about and relating to their pets. Thanks to the efforts of this new community of scientists, we now have a vastly improved understanding of how dogs' minds work, specifically how dogs gather and interpret information about the world around them, and how they react emotionally to varying situations. Some of this research has revealed startling differences between dogs and people, suggesting that it is both desirable and possible for dog owners to think dog, rather than simply assuming that whatever they themselves are sensing and feeling, their dog must be sensing and feeling too. Although the new science about dog behavior has the potential to put the dog's role in human society back on track, little of the research has been made available outside of obscure academic texts until now. In this audiobook, I attempt to translate for the general listeners and dog lovers the exciting new developments in canine science. Doing so requires me to overturn a great deal of conventional wisdom about dogs and how we should interact with them. In the first half of the book, I show that the most up-to-date account of the dog's origins, while confirming that the wolf is indeed the dog's only ancestor, reveals a very different image of dog's nature than seemed to be the case only 2 decades ago. Dogs may be constructed from wolf DNA, but this does not mean that they are compelled to behave or think like wolves. Indeed, domestication has changed dogs' minds and behaviors to the point where such comparisons can be a hindrance rather than an aid to any genuine understanding of our pets. The new science of dog behavior has dramatic implications for humans and for our choice of the best and most humane ways to train our dogs. A word of caution here, though. This book is not a training manual. Rather, its purpose is to show where modern ideas about dog training have come from, so that owners themselves can effectively evaluate whether the training manuals or trainers they have chosen really know what they are talking about. After revising the story of the dog's origins, I will explore what might loosely be referred to as dog's brain power. Scientists have recently turned their attention to the kinds of beliefs that owners have about their dog's emotional and intellectual capabilities, and their findings are demonstrating how accurate, but also how mistaken, these beliefs can be. It's an integral aspect of human nature to attribute feelings not just to animals, but also to inanimate objects. To speak, for example, of an angry sky or the cruel sea. And yet, until a few decades ago, it was anybody's guess as to what emotions different animals might have. Many scientists, moreover, used to regard emotions as simply too subjective to be accessible to serious study. While animal intelligence has been studied for more than 100 years, hardly anyone considered dogs worthy of study until perhaps the end of the 20th century. Since then, research has significantly changed the ways in which we think about dogs' minds. The new canine science reveals that dogs are both smarter and dumber than we think they are. For example, they have an almost uncanny ability to guess what humans are about to do because of their extreme sensitivity to our body language. But they are also trapped in the moment, incapable of projecting the consequences of their actions backward or forward in time. If owners were able to appreciate their dog's intelligence and emotional life for what it actually is, rather than for what they imagine it to be, then dogs would not just be better understood, they'd be better treated as well. Just as canine science can inform human attitudes about dogs' minds, it can also tell us how dogs experience and interpret the world around them. Physically speaking, a dog and his or her owner live in the same house, visit the same park together for exercise, travel in the same car, meet the same friends and acquaintances. However, the types of information arriving at the dog's brain and the owner's brain in each of those situations are profoundly different. We are visual creatures. Dogs primarily rely on their sense of smell. We refer to high-pitched noises that we can't hear, e.g. the squeaking of bats, as ultrasound. Dogs would, if they could, scoff at our inability to hear such sounds, which they pick up perfectly. To fully appreciate our dog's world, we need science to tell us what they can and can't detect, what they find pleasant and what they would object to if they could. For example, I don't suppose your dog has ever been bothered by the colors you've picked out to decorate your house, but his or her delicate nose was very likely insulted by the odor of the drying paint. Although our lack of understanding of dogs' nature often compromises their well-being, it pales into insignificance beside the problems we have generated for pedigree dogs through excessive inbreeding. Rigid breed standards encourage breeders to eliminate all traits that don't fit the perfect type. In theory, this should allow breeders to select for traits that would create healthy and well-adjusted, if rather uniform, animals. But in practice, it has led to the appearance of an extensive range of inherited defects that compromise the welfare of large numbers of dogs in many, many breeds. Science, thankfully, can help to get dog breeding back on track. While it is beyond the scope of this book to provide a detailed manual of canine genetics, the penultimate chapter addresses the underlying principles that breeders should be following, emphasizing what it is about pedigree breeding that directly affects dogs' well-being. In the final chapters of the book, I look at how science can help dogs to adjust to 21st century life. Currently, most of the attention given to dogs' breeding has focused on endowing them with superficial rather than practical traits. Many pet dogs are essentially breeders' rejects, deemed unlikely to reach the perfection demanded by the breed standard. Puppies who look as though they are never going to become champions in the show ring are the ones who become pets. Surely the needs of the pet dog deserve more attention than that. As dog owners and dog lovers, we need to think constructively about how to breed dogs whose primary purpose is not to herd sheep, retrieve game, or win prizes at dog shows, but rather to be rewarding, obedient, healthy, happy family pets. In writing this book, I have tried to promote a greater understanding and appreciation of the special place that dogs hold in human society. If these aims can be achieved, they should go a long way towards sustaining and reinforcing our relationship with our beloved companions as the next decades unfold. Chapter 1. Where Dogs Came From. The Wolf in Your Living Room. A powerful image that reminds dog owners that their trusted companion is, under the skin, an animal, not a person. Dogs are indeed wolves, at least as far as their DNA is concerned. The two animals share 99.96% of their genes. Following the same logic, you might just as well say that wolves are dogs, but surprisingly, no one does. Wolves are generally portrayed as wild, ancestral, and primeval, whereas dogs tend to be cast in the role of the wolf's artificial, controlled, subservient derivatives. Yet dogs, in terms of sheer numbers, are far more successful in the modern world than wolves are. So what do we gain from knowing that wolves and dogs share a common ancestor? Many books, articles, and TV programs about dog behavior have claimed that understanding the wolf is the key to understanding the domestic dog. I disagree. My view is that the key to understanding the domestic dog is, first and foremost, to understand the domestic dog, and it's a view I share with an increasing number of scientists worldwide. By analyzing the dog as its own animal rather than as a lesser version of the wolf, we have the opportunity to understand it and refine our dealings with it as never before. To be sure, it's undeniable that dogs share many of their basic characteristics with other members of the dog family, the canidae, of which the wolf is a part. Dogs evolved from canids, and they owe such qualities as their basic anatomy, their refined sense of smell, their ability to retrieve, and their capacity to form lasting social bonds to this evolution. To some extent, then, comparing dogs to their wild ancestors can be illuminating, but when the wolf is taken as the only available point of reference, our understanding of dogs suffers. At the most fundamental level, dogs are distinguished by the fact that, unlike wolves or other canids, they have adapted to live alongside human beings, the result of the process of domestication. As dogs have been altered by domestication, many of the subtleties and sophistications of wolf behavior appear to have been stripped away, leaving an animal that is still recognizably a canid, but no longer a wolf. Domestication has altered the dog considerably, more than any other species. It's self-evident that dogs come in a wide range of shapes and sizes. Indeed, there's more size variation among domestic dogs than in the whole of the rest of the dog family put together. Yet this is by no means the only profound effect of domestication. Perhaps the most important one, for both us and our dogs, is their ability to bond with us and understand us to an extent that no other animal can match. Understanding what has happened during domestication is therefore a key element in understanding the dog. To understand the domestic dog fully, we need to look beyond the process of domestication, beyond even the wolf, to examine the dog's entire history. We need to know where the dog came from and what all its ancestors were like, not just its closest living relative, the wolf. Of course, it is ultimately impossible for us to know precisely how the domestic dog's ancestors behaved, whether we are examining its immediate forebears, wolves that lived more than 10,000 years ago, or its more distant ancestors, social canids, the precursors of the wolf in the Pliocene era several million years ago. They are all extinct. We can, however, get some idea of how they might have behaved by examining the range of behavior that is characteristic of today's social canids. Indeed, a detailed examination of the behavior of those species would not only shed light onto the dog's earliest ancestors, but also help us work out why it was that, apart from the wolf, none of the canids were successfully and permanently domesticated. DNA analysis leaves no doubt that the dog is descended only, or at least almost entirely, from the gray wolf, Canis lupus. The first comprehensive sequencing of the maternal DNA of dogs, wolves, coyotes, and jackals, published in 1997, produced no evidence that dogs had ancestors in any species other than the gray wolf. None of the dozens of investigations performed since then have contradicted this. However, there is still a relative lack of data on paternal DNA, which is more difficult to analyze. So it is still possible that a few types of dog could claim descent from other canids through their paternal line. Genetically, dogs and wolves have a great deal in common, but the mere fact that two species have considerable overlap in their DNA doesn't mean that their behavior will be the same. Indeed, many animals with similar DNA are drastically different from one another, especially in terms of behavior. We know this thanks to the DNA revolution, which has led to the sequencing of the genomes of humans, canines, felines, and an increasing number of other species. Many of these sequences exhibit a remarkable degree of similarity. For example, your DNA and your dog's are identical for about 25% of their length, which is perhaps not surprising given that you are both mammals. Roughly the same 25% is also found in mice. The other 75% accounts for why dogs, mice, and people look and behave very differently from one another. Species that are much more closely related to one another than we are to dogs can share almost their entire DNA sequences, and it's tempting to assume that they must therefore be restricted to the same range of behavior. But DNA doesn't control behavior directly. Rather, it specifies the structure of proteins and other constituents of cells, such that a tiny change in DNA can lead to a huge change in behavior. For example, there is no blueprint for the brain. Each nerve cell in the brain emerges out of interactions between thousands of DNA sequences. A change in one letter in those sequences could have an enormous effect on the way the brain functions, or none at all. We simply don't know enough yet about how DNA and behavior interact. Take two closely related apes, the chimpanzee and the bonobo. Common chimps share 99.6% of their DNA with bonobos. Yet the social behavior of these two kinds of great ape couldn't be more different. Common chimps are omnivorous, often hunting other kinds of monkey, and their social groups are based on coalitions between males, who are highly aggressive toward outsiders and may even murder them if they get the chance. Bonobos, on the other hand, are vegetarian, live in societies centered on groups of related females, rarely show aggression, and have never been seen to murder in the wild. Genetically almost identical, the two species are vastly different in behavior. Like bonobos and chimpanzees, dogs and gray wolves share most of their DNA, but there seems little reason to presume that based on this fact, they must inevitably share the same social systems as well. In fact, domestication appears to have dissolved away much of the detail of wolf's specific behavior in dogs, leaving them with a behavioral repertoire that has much in common with that of slightly more distantly related species, such as the coyote Canis latrans, and even some more distant relatives in the same family, such as the golden jackal Canis aureus. Even to early biologists, the differences between dogs' behavior and that of wolves were obvious. Many of these differences are manifested socially. Dogs, for instance, are clearly not pack animals, although they do occasionally form groups, and they are much more adept than wolves at forming relationships with people. Over the years, many eminent biologists, including Nobel Prize winner Conrad Lorenz, and even Charles Darwin himself, have been struck by the flexibility of the dog's behavior, as well as by the enormous size difference between the smallest and largest breeds. Both suggested that domestic dogs must be some kind of hybrid between two or even several of the canids. Lorenz, in his charming book Man Meets Dog, was convinced that wolves were far too independent in nature to explain the indiscriminate friendliness shown by many dogs, and proposed that most of the breeds that had originated in Europe were predominantly jackal in origin. He later retracted this idea, having realized that there was no evidence for spontaneous crossbreeding between dogs and jackals, as readily happens between dogs and wolves, and that the details of jackal behavior didn't fit that of the dogs. The jackal's howl, for example, is nothing like any dog's. Despite these scientists' best efforts to determine why dogs are so different from wolves in their behavior, the puzzle was not resolved and remains largely unanswered to this day. Yet perhaps some clues can be gathered if we look further back in evolutionary time, thinking of our domestic dog as a product not of one species, the gray wolf, but of a whole family, the canidae, also referred to as the dog family, as previously noted, but hereafter referred to as canids to avoid confusion with the domestic dog. Many of the canid species have sophisticated social lives, which, when they overlap with those of dogs, can potentially shed light on the origins of dog behavior. Coyotes, for instance, are much more promiscuous than wolves, a characteristic shared with dogs. Although the behavioral traits of other canids are not as well understood or well publicized as those of the gray wolf, they nevertheless have a great deal to tell us about when and how dog behavior may have originated. Tracing the canids back to their origins reveals that their social intelligence was likely one of the early traits that set dogs' ancient ancestors apart. Canids probably first evolved some 6 million years ago in North America, where they eventually replaced another type of dog-like mammal, the barophagene. This was a large hyena-like animal that specialized in scavenging and had massive bone-crushing jaws to match. The original canids, which probably looked more like foxes than dogs, must have been little Davids to the cumbersome barophagene Goliaths, out-competing them in speed, cunning, and intelligence, and ultimately helping to drive them to extinction. If we then fast forward a mere 1.5 million years, we find that the surviving canids had spread all over the world and split into several types, one of which was the ancestor of today's dogs, wolves, and jackals, collectively referred to as canis. Subsequently, further diversification produced three strands of evolution, any one of which could potentially have culminated in a domestic animal. For there is nothing in the behavior of any of the canid lineages to suggest that they could not have produced an animal that was suitable for domestication. Indeed, it is likely that at least two of the three did produce domestic animals, and entirely possible that the wolf was not the only species in its lineage to be domesticated. The first evolutionary break within the canis genus occurred in North America, and eventually, about 1 million years ago, gave rise to today's coyote, still confined to that continent. Another group emerged in South America, where they live to this day and are classified as Dusicyon rather than canis. Rather misleadingly, they are collectively known as South American foxes, though they are only distantly related to the much better known red fox of hunting fame. The other six species of canis all evolved in the Old World, most likely in Eurasia, although some possibly in Africa. Four of these are jackals, although one of these, the simian jackal, is sometimes confusingly referred to as the Ethiopian wolf. They include the golden jackal that Lorentz thought might have been the origin of some breeds of dog. The other is the gray wolf Canis lupus, the ancestor of our domestic dogs. Of the Eurasian canids, only the gray wolf reached North America, migrating across the Bering land bridge 100,000 years ago, during one of the periods when Alaska was joined to Asia. Many of these species superficially seem to be potential candidates for domestication, thanks to a number of social tools that they share with the domestic dog. All can, when conditions are favorable, live in family groups or packs. All seem able to adapt their lifestyle, specifically whether they live alone or in small or large groups, to the circumstances they find themselves in. Nowadays, the most important such circumstance for all wild canids is often our own species' activities, whether direct persecution or incidental provision of food at garbage dumps. The current consensus is that the canid genome is rather like a Swiss Army knife, a social toolkit that has remained resistant to evolutionary change and can be used to cope with a wide variety of circumstances, ranging from solitary living when times are hard to complex societies when food is plentiful and persecution is at a minimum. The success of the domestic dog in adapting so well to life with humans can therefore be seen not as a specific set of changes that began only with the gray wolf, but rather as a new use for this ancient canid social toolkit, one that allowed the dog to socialize not just with other members of the same species, but also with members of ours. While we are now certain that the gray wolf is the domestic dog's one and only direct ancestor, the dog shares its earlier ancestors with many other still-living relatives, each of whom may offer us a new perspective on these ancient forebears. The dog's lineage, after all, goes back much further than that of the gray wolf, specifically to canids that are now extinct but were themselves the ancestors of all of today's living canids. Each of the latter has something to tell us about the ways that canids can adapt to fit different circumstances, that is, construct their social groups, and therefore each provides a different set of clues as to what the canid toolkit may have looked like as it emerged some 5 million years ago. As all of these canids carry the same toolkit, the fact that none apart from the wolf has been successfully domesticated will also need to be accounted for. The golden jackal, Canis aureus, is one of the dog's most social relatives, and therefore a seemingly ideal candidate for domestication. It is the only jackal to be found in the Fertile Crescent, the cradle of civilization, where many other domestications, including sheep, goats, and cattle, occurred. All the other jackals are restricted to Africa. Like many of the other canids, the golden jackal shows considerable flexibility in its social arrangements. A few hunt alone, but most live in male-female pairs, often bonding for life, which can be 6 to 8 years in length. If one partner dies, the other rarely finds a new mate. Very often, some of the first litter that a pair produces will stay with their parents until the next litter is born the following year, and will then help to bring them up, before leaving to find their own mates a few months later. They protect the young at the den while their parents are off hunting, or, if they catch something themselves, will often bring it back to share with the cubs. Cubs are more likely to survive if their elder brothers and sisters stay on to help, so their contribution is valuable. Jackals often hunt in pairs, enabling them to tackle larger prey than they could alone, and sometimes the helpers may hunt with them to make up a pack of 3 or 4. The family members have a rich vocabulary for communicating with one another, just as wolves do. Based on its wealth of social skills, there seems little reason why the golden jackal could not have become domesticated as the grey wolf did. In fact, a recent archaeological find provides hints that the golden jackal may indeed have been domesticated in Turkey. Göbekli Tepe, an early Neolithic hilltop site in the southeastern region of that country, appears to be a temple, an arrangement of huge stones erected a staggering 11,000 years ago, more than twice as old as Stonehenge. These stones, which predate agriculture and metal tools, are covered in highly stylized carvings of people and animals and birds. Some are T-shaped, with the head of the T representing the head of a person, and the upright part, the body. Many of the animals portrayed are potentially menacing: lions, snakes, spiders, vultures, scorpions. The absence of domesticated animals is unsurprising. These stones were carved by hunter-gatherers, long before any animal was domesticated for food. A few of the carvings clearly depict dog-like animals, which archaeologists have labeled as foxes, just another sort of potentially harmful animal. Yet on one stone, a fox is depicted in the crook of a man's arm, more the place for a pet than an enemy, making it unlikely that the drawing depicts a red fox, as that animal is solitary and therefore a very unlikely candidate for domestication. And although it's hard to be sure, the carving does not look much like a wolf either. Its fox-like features and bushy tail make it much more likely to be a jackal, and the only jackal native to that area is the golden jackal. Perhaps Conrad Lorenz's idea of a jackal origin for dogs was only half wrong. Maybe jackals were domesticated once, over 10,000 years ago, but were less well adapted to living with humans than wolves were, and so died out or returned to the wild. To find a similar example of a failed domestication, but one that survived into recorded history, we need to travel to South America. Coincidentally, this example also involves a fox, one of a group of fox-like dogs that evolved in South America some 3 million years ago. One of these, the Calpeo fox, Dusicyon calpeus, was domesticated, or at least tamed, living with people but still only breeding in the wild. These animals came to be known as aguara dogs. At the end of the 18th century, the English soldier turned scientist and explorer Charles Hamilton Smith noted that these dogs could be found in hunter-gatherer villages. They would accompany the men on hunting trips, although they appear not to have made themselves particularly useful, and would often come home on their own after a few hours. In the villages, they would scavenge for food or go off on short hunting expeditions of their own, where they would eat almost anything they could find, including fish, crabs, limpets, lizards, toads, and snakes. By the middle of the 19th century, however, aguara dogs had disappeared, replaced by the much more obedient and useful dogs that the Europeans had brought with them to the continent. It is difficult to work out why the Aguara dog did not progress to full domestication, because very little is known about the habits of its wild ancestor, the Calpio fox. However, none of the South American foxes regularly form groups of more than two, so it is likely that their social abilities were just too undeveloped to be adapted to include relationships with humans. In North America, the most likely candidate for domestication, apart from the immigrant gray wolf, is the coyote, Canis latrans. The traditional image of this member of the dog family is that of a solitary hunter, but the coyote is in fact a highly social animal whose appetite for livestock has led it to be persecuted by humans. Left to their own devices, coyotes live in pairs, and as with the golden jackal, these can turn into small packs when 1 year's offspring remain with their parents to assist with the next litter. This is most likely to be possible when large prey such as elk and white-tailed deer are available, providing both the necessity and the opportunity for the coyotes to hunt as a pack. In this, they may rival the wolf in terms of the sophistication of their social lives. Nevertheless, neither they nor, as we shall see, the wolves of North America ever appear to have been domesticated. The reason may simply be that by the time humans colonized North America, they already had dogs, and thus no need for any alternative. It is possible, however, that some coyote genes have found their way into modern American dogs. The reverse has certainly happened, inasmuch as about 10% of wild coyotes carry genes from domestic dogs. Although it is possible that these are the progeny of matings between female coyotes and male dogs, it is unlikely that a domestic dog would be sufficiently bold to impress a wild coyote bitch. More likely, they are the result of male coyotes forcing themselves on female dogs, whose puppies then escaped and joined the local coyote population. The more tractable of these offspring might have subsequently bred with other dogs, inserting coyote genes permanently into the dog population. Finally, our journey takes us to Africa, the birthplace of our own species, and an area in which domestication would therefore seem highly plausible. This continent is rich in canids, including four species of jackal, the golden jackal among them, as well as the African wild dog, undoubtedly a rival for the grey wolf's claim to be the most sociable of the canids. The African wild dog's packs are larger than the wolf's. Up to 50 individuals have been seen hunting together, although the typical number of adults in a pack is 8. In the open grasslands, which the African wild dog favors, cooperative hunting is essential for survival. Only a pack can defend kills against other large predators, such as lions and hyenas. Not that African wild dogs are particularly small themselves, they are the size of a small German shepherd, but with a brindled coat and huge upright ears. After they have made a kill, the food is shared amicably between all pack members. If there are cubs back in the den, each dog will eat more than usual and regurgitate some to feed the young upon returning home. For most of the year, relationships between the members of a pack of African wild dogs are friendly. Every morning and evening, they engage in a greeting ritual, running around excitedly, thrusting their noses into each other's faces, a mimicry of the begging behavior that they used when they were cubs, and producing a squeaking noise that makes them sound more like a troop of monkeys than a pack of dogs. Once the adults have become sufficiently hyped up by all this chatter, they run off together on the hunt. Pack members will occasionally quarrel with one another, but serious fighting is rare, until one of the females comes into season. When she is ready to mate, the dominant female becomes seriously aggressive toward the other adult females, and it is not unknown for her to inflict serious injuries on them. As a result, she usually is the only female in the pack to produce a litter each year. If one of the other females also produces a litter, the dominant female may try to kill her cubs, though sometimes all the cubs get mixed up together and both mothers look after them. Despite this occasional violence within groups of African wild dogs, the high level of cooperation in wild dog packs suggests that they should be easy to domesticate. For example, they have a complex vocabulary of vocalizations. Twitters, begging cries, gurgles, yelps, squeals, whimpers, whines, moans, hoos, growls, and barks that would seem ideally suited for communication with such a vocal species as ourselves, far more so than the rather taciturn wolf. Yet there seems to be no evidence that any attempt was ever made to domesticate this species. Considered in the broader context of domestication as a whole, however, this failure may be less surprising. Despite mankind having evolved in Africa and therefore having a much longer history there than anywhere else, almost all the significant domestications of animals have taken place on other continents. It's been suggested that the human race needed to get outside its evolutionary comfort zone before becoming sufficiently motivated to domesticate animals, or indeed plants. Perhaps the African wild dog was simply in the wrong place to become part of our world. While the histories of the canids vary from place to place and species to species, two of the dog's distant cousins, the golden jackal and the South American Culpeo fox, provide tantalizing glimpses of domestications that seem to have begun but were never completed. Each occurred on a different continent, one in Eurasia, the other in South America, and in very different societies. This points again to the importance of the 5-million-year-old canid toolkit, flexible sociality, a good nose, expertise in hunting, as being the key to the suitability of canids for domestication. And yet neither of these experiments in domestication was, in the long run, successful. Domestications occur only when a human need meets a suitable species, assuming that the need is backed up by sufficient resources. Such conditions seem to occur very rarely, as attested by the tiny number of mammalian species that mankind has fully domesticated, a number that barely scrapes into double figures. It seems entirely possible that all the species discussed so far could have been domesticated, except that the conditions for domestication were never as ideal or could not be sustained for as long as those of the domestic dog. Finally, we must turn to the grey wolf as the only one of the canids to have been domesticated successfully, if by successfully we mean surviving into the modern world. Indeed, the domestic dog is very successful. The 400 million or so dogs in the world outnumber wolves over 1,000-fold. A few hundred years ago, there were probably only about 5 million wolves in the world. Today, there are only 150,000 to 300,000. If we set aside the artificial distinction of domestication for a moment, we could say that the wolf has evolved into the dog, leaving behind a few highly totemic vestiges of its past that hang on by a thread in the wild. Some wolves were able to take advantage of man's domination of the globe and became dogs. Others were not, and stayed wolves. No account of dog behavior can afford to ignore the wolf, if only because many books on dogs place such emphasis on the dog's wolf-like nature. But wolves themselves have, as it turns out, been fundamentally misunderstood. A great deal has been written about the gray wolf, but much of that is either misconceived or at least unhelpful when it comes to understanding the behavior of modern domestic dogs. In the past, the wolf has been portrayed as the quintessential pack animal, and its packs have been portrayed as being essentially despotic, rigidly and aggressively controlled by an alpha pair. Logically, therefore, as a descendant of the wolf, the dog was thought to be the same under the skin. Undoubtedly less aggressive in nature, but nevertheless born with the expectation that it must eventually seek to dominate all those around it, canine and human alike. The past decade has seen a radical reappraisal of the wolf pack, however, regarding both how it constructs itself and the evolutionary forces that drive it. Our conception of the dog is therefore overdue for revision. If wolves are not despots, as we now know, then why should we assume that domestic dogs are impelled to take control of their owners? Like most other canids, grey wolves are highly social animals and have a strong preference for living in groups. This is not to say that individuals do not live alone from time to time, but it is not usually from choice. A lone wolf may have been driven out of its pack, or may have been forced to forage on its own when there was not enough food available to feed two wolves traveling together. But wherever possible, wolves try to live together. Even wolves that scavenge from garbage dumps do so in groups, usually with between 3 and 5 members. The wildcat, the domestic cat's ancestor, has also occasionally been observed feeding on rubbish, but always alone. It's undoubtedly this thirst for company that, among other factors, made it possible for wolves to be domesticated. Although they are fundamentally sociable animals, wolves are also remarkably adaptable when it comes to their living arrangements, another trait that, perhaps even more than sociability itself, makes them especially good candidates for domestication. Wolves come together when local conditions permit and go their own ways in times of adversity. They can live alone or in small groups. When conditions are right, larger groups comprising 6 to 10 adults can form. As a rule, these larger groups occur only where the main prey available is also large, typically moose, caribou, or bison. Although a solitary wolf could probably kill a caribou, especially one that was old, young, or sick, the wolf would risk getting injured itself and would thus be more apt to seek smaller, less dangerous prey. Pack hunting is most likely a safer and more efficient way of hunting large animals, but this appears not to be the key to why packs can exist. What is probably more important in determining the formation of large packs is that a kill of one of these large animals provides far more food than a single wolf could consume. In summer, when alternative prey is often available, these larger packs tend to fragment into smaller units, perhaps coming back together again in autumn. It is flexibility such as this that's now seen as a second crucial factor allowing wolves, a few of them at least, to adapt to living with humans. The nature of wolf packs is crucial to understanding the social behavior of wolves, and thus the behavioral inheritance of domestic dogs. But until recently, wolf packs have been wrongly thought of as competitive organizations. It's now known that the majority of wolf packs are simply family groups. Typically, a solitary male will pair up with a solitary female. Either or both will most likely have recently left a pack and raise a litter together. In many species, the young leave or are chased away when they are old enough to fend for themselves, but not so in wolves. Provided that no one is starving, the cubs may stay with their parents until they are fully grown. Once they are experienced enough, they will participate fully in hunting, and thus a pack emerges. Often the younger members will still be part of the pack when the next litter of cubs is born, and will help their parents to raise their brothers and sisters, bringing food back for them and babysitting them when the other members of the pack are out hunting. Contrary to many notions of wolf behavior, cooperation, not dominance, seems to be the essence of the wolf pack. Modern biology demands explanations for the seemingly selfless behavior exhibited by the younger adult wolves operating within a pack. Logically speaking, a gene that influences one animal to help another to breed should die out, since it will be the animals not carrying the unselfish version of the gene who will leave the most offspring. Cooperative breeding must therefore have long-term advantages that outweigh its disadvantages. Biologists have been arguing for the past 5 decades about what the finer points of those advantages might be and how they are expressed, but the theory of kin selection, first proposed in the 1960s, accounts for why cooperative breeding is much more likely to occur in families than in random assemblages of individuals. By ascribing a benefit to the cooperation observed within wolf packs, scientists have been able to use the theory of kin selection to make sense of behavior that would otherwise be unintelligible. Offering cooperation to an unrelated animal carries risks, even in animals as smart as wolves. There is a danger, after all, that the favor may not be returned. On the other hand, performing a favor for a close relative, say a son or a daughter, has genetic advantages. Even if that favor is never returned, the helper is still promoting the survival of some of his or her own genes, specifically those versions that are identical in the relative. In a son or daughter, there would be a 50% overlap, the other half coming from the other parent. This advantage does not seem sufficient to promote lifelong abstinence from breeding. The only mammals that exhibit such abstinence are naked mole rats, which burrow beneath harsh deserts where a single breeding pair is unlikely to survive for long, even with the other's help. Nevertheless, kin selection does seem to be powerful enough to sustain temporary abdication from breeding, making it worthwhile for offspring to help their parents until the family group gets too large to sustain itself and the offspring leave to start families of their own. Kin selection explains that when the younger members of the pack appear to deliberately put their own breeding rights to one side, they are actually acting in their own interest. But the advantages of this behavior are not purely familial. In addition to the advantage they gain from kin selection, it is also safer for the wolves themselves not to leave their pack while they are still young. Their lack of experience means that their chances of forming their own pack are actually rather slim. This accounts for the rare occasions when unrelated wolves have been recorded as joining existing packs. It appears that in such cases they are being recruited as a replacement when one of the most experienced members of the pack, maybe one of the original founders, leaves or dies. Packs that form naturally in the wild are usually harmonious entities, with aggression being the exception rather than the norm. As in any family, there are occasional conflicts of interest within wolf packs, but in general the parents have to do very little to keep their grown-up young in order. The young are essentially volunteers. They could leave the family and set up their own, but they choose not to, preferring to stay safely within the family unit until they are older and more experienced, and hence more likely to survive the risks of finding a mate and a new place to live. They regularly reinforce their bond with their parents, and at the same time reassure them that they are helpers, not rivals, by performing a special ritual. The youngster crouches slightly as it approaches the parent, ears back and close to its head, and tail held low and wagging. It then nuzzles the side of the parent's face, an imitation of the food-soliciting behavior that it used when it was a cub. This is very similar to the greeting ritual of the African wild dog, and so possibly a very ancient canid behavior, predating the evolution of both wolf and wild dog. The image of a harmonious pack is not the picture of wolf society that you will find in most books on dog behavior. Wolf biologists originally based most of their ideas on captive packs, which were easy to observe. Some of these packs were random assemblies of unrelated individuals, while others were fragments of packs, usually with one or both of the parents missing, basically composed of whatever individuals were available for the zoo to make an exhibit. What almost all of these packs had in common was that their structure had been irrevocably disrupted by captivity, so that the wolves were thrown into a state of confusion and conflict. Moreover, unless their human captors decided to separate them, none had the opportunity to leave. As a result, the relationships that emerged were based not on long-established trust, but on rivalry and aggression. The true picture of wolf society emerged only as wolves became protected, allowing packs to form and thrive over several years, without becoming fragmented by continual persecution. At roughly the same time, better technology for tracking and observing wolves in the wild became available. GPS, miniature radio transmitters with batteries robust enough to allow tracking over a whole season, and so on. Within a decade, descriptions of wolf society had changed from the image of the hierarchical pack run by two tyrants, one male, one female, to that of the harmonious family group, where, barring accidents, the younger adults in the family voluntarily assisted their parents in raising their younger brothers and sisters. Coercion was replaced by cooperation as the underlying principle. This radical change in our conception of pack behavior has required that we also reappraise the social signals that wolves use. Under zoo conditions, signals that wolf parents would normally use to remind their offspring to cooperate instead became the precursors of out-and-out fighting and were labeled dominance indicators. Similarly, the cohesive behaviors that adult young wolves would normally use to bond with their parents were now being used in desperate attempts to avoid conflict, and so came to be labeled as submission. Contrary to long-standing theories of wolf behavior, it is now believed that submissive behavior may be nothing of the sort. An effective submissive display should, by definition, indicate to an attacker that the attack is not worth pursuing. And indeed, when wolves from two different packs happen to meet, the smaller one will try to avoid being attacked by performing such a display. This rarely works, however. And if the smaller wolf fails to run away, it will be attacked and often killed by the larger. Wolves from different packs have no common interests. They compete for food and are probably only very distantly related, if at all. Nevertheless, if the submissive display was truly an indication of submission, it ought to work in these circumstances, since the attacking wolf is putting itself at risk of injury, even if it wins. The fact that this display doesn't work under these circumstances indicates that it isn't a submissive display at all. Moreover, when it's performed between members of the same family, for the most part it is not preceded by any form of threat from the recipient. Rather, it usually appears spontaneously, reinforcing the bond between the members of the pack. Only in artificially constituted packs kept in zoos do submissive displays come to be a standard response to threat. Presumably, the younger, weaker wolves learn by trial and error that such displays sometimes work under these unnatural circumstances, where pack loyalties have been totally disrupted and there is nowhere for them to escape to. Wolves perform two signals that used to be labeled submissive, active and passive. Domestic dogs perform very similar signals, and these too are referred to as active submission and passive submission. One might expect that any reinterpretation of these signals in the wolf would quickly have been followed by a reappraisal of what they mean when performed by dogs, but this has been slow to happen. The active display is the more common one among wolves, and, rather than being a sign of submission, is in fact a bonding signal that scientists now refer to, much more appropriately, as the affiliation display. In the affiliation display, the wolf approaches with a low posture, holding its tail low. Its ears are pulled slightly back, and its tail and hindquarters wag enthusiastically. This display forms part of what's called the group ceremony, which occurs when the pack reassembles or as a precursor to a hunting trip. Under these circumstances, it can be performed by the parents, the alphas, as well as by their offspring, confirming its role as a mechanism whereby affectionate bonds are reinforced. It's difficult to figure out how this display was ever labeled as submissive behavior. A wolf performing the affiliation display is actually in a rather good position to attack its recipient. A swift twist of the head, and it could sink its teeth into the other's throat. Therefore, accepting the performance of the affiliation display is, if anything, more an expression of trust on the recipient's part than on the performer's. It's undeniable that the younger members of the family perform the affiliation display toward their parents much more frequently than vice versa. But this behavior is typical of all parent-offspring relationships and does not mean that the offspring are allowing themselves to be dominated by their parents. Indeed, it simply reflects the asymmetry of the relationship between parents and offspring. The parents are the only parents that each of the young wolves is likely ever to have, and therefore their attachment is total. The parents may, indeed probably do, have other offspring, so their attachment to each cub must unavoidably be a shared one. Also in urgent need of reinterpretation is the wolf's other, less common submissive display, passive submission. Unlike the affiliation display, this may be an actual sign of submission, one that is derived from an infantile behavior in which cubs roll over to allow their mother to groom their belly and stimulate urination, which the cubs cannot yet do on their own. This display, which seems to have been adopted by adults as a way of deflecting possible attack, involves one wolf lying down, rolling onto its back, and exposing its abdomen for inspection by another. Some wolf biologists now refer to it as the belly-up display, which is more descriptive and presumes nothing about its function. Nevertheless, this display has precisely the characteristics one would expect of submission, since the wolf that performs it is placing itself in a position where it is at the mercy of the other. In wolves, the belly-up display is much rarer than the affiliation display, and is more commonly seen in captive wolves than in the wild. When observed in zoos, it is most likely to be performed by wolves that are on the fringes of the captive packs, are often involved in fights, and rarely participate in group howls. These are the very wolves that would almost certainly have gone off on their own if the fence surrounding their enclosure hadn't been there. Continually stressed by being forced to remain in close quarters with other wolves that threaten to attack them at every turn, these outcasts will try any tactic that might deflect aggression. In cases where the affiliation display fails, behaving like a helpless cub evidently works, so they learn to use it when they are in desperation. Thus, in wolves, this display may be an artifact of captivity, not a normal part of adult behavior at all, but rather a signal artificially carried over from infancy into adulthood under unnatural circumstances. Studies of wild wolf packs have made clear that the traditional interpretations of wolf submission, both aggression within the pack and the submissive behavior that is an attempt to defuse or deflect this aggression, reflect artifacts of captivity, and therefore cannot be applied to wolves as a species. Wolf packs that have not been manipulated by man and are allowed to manage their own affairs, so to speak, are generally peaceful. This is not to say that all of what has been written about aggression between wolves is wrong. For instance, it is an undeniable fact that wolves, captive or not, can be very forceful and aggressive when they want to be. In the wild, even though relationships within packs are usually congenial, aggression toward outsiders, though infrequent, is unrestrained and potentially fatal. In captivity, however, pack identity is either non-existent or severely disrupted, resulting in the expression of behaviors that would normally be seen only in skirmishes between members of different packs. Observations of captive wolf packs have led not only to mistaken assessments of wolf behavior, but also to fundamental misunderstandings about the structure of wolf families themselves, misunderstandings that have warped the popular conception of dogs as well. In captive wolf packs, the breeding pair are conventionally referred to as the alpha male and the alpha female. Many dog trainers, borrowing from this conception, insist that owners must impress their own alpha status on their dog.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.